colleagues of mine, Lorenzo Bruni, Elizabeth Anne Jacobi, Will Vorn, and Louis-Philippe de Mer, for having accepted our invitation. And I'm in debt with my colleagues at the Perk Laboratory of the Sport Sant'Anna, Dr. Francesca Farinelli and Dr. Chiara Evangelista. And then my deepest thanks to Dr. Eva Pierini. She helped me a lot in the preparation of this day, so thank you very much for being here. And as you will see, robotic art is assuming more importance in the framework of contemporary art. In my opinion, it is important that in the framework of a festival of robotics, it is important to spend some effort in trying to describe the last achievements of robotic art, in particular how robots are utilized today in the artistic scenario. And as you see, the topic is robotics, and in particular you will see some of the realizations, of the installations, of the artworks that exploit robots that has been introduced in the last years. And you can see how the robot is considered in contemporary art, and or better, in what is called now new media art. It is a flexible component. It can be seen in different shapes, in different arrangements, you know. And the interesting thing is how robot in art could be exploited for developing new paradigms of interactions with humans. And in fact, robotic art, theoretically, is very close to topics like human-machine interfaces or human-robot interfaces. Artists have always used different techniques and also different materials to realize the artworks, from drawings, paintings, you know, various forms of sculptures and different materials, even biological for pictorial art, oil paintings, you know, and 500 years later photography in different forms of photography. So I think that also robots can be considered as an interesting, innovative technique for developing art. I just want to show you briefly how our laboratory entered, in which form of works entered in this field. You know, the research in our lab started at the end of 1980s, 1989, where the laboratory has been set up. And the main work has been that of robotics. Our main objectives in terms of research has been that of developing wearable robots, in particular robotic exoskeleton and haptic interfaces. And in the mid-1990s, we started research also on virtual environments and augmented reality. So you will see how wearable robots and virtual environments are the two main backbones of our research. Here you can see an example of the wearable robots that we are developing, which is kind of upper arm, upper limb exoskeletons that can be used for neural rehabilitation. This is a new component developed a few years ago. And you see how clearly there is a strong relationship between the movements of the user and the machine. We are working also at a different scale of human-robot interaction, in particular this kind of wearable robots that are called body extenders, are able not only to follow the movements of the human operator, but also to augment their lifting capabilities. In particular, this is a machine that weighs 160 kilograms, very heavy, but it covers 22 degrees of freedom of the upper limb and lower limb, also the back. And you can see it's worn by the human being, and the human being exploits its movement in order to move the machine, but when it is necessary to lift a specific payload, even 50 kilograms per hand, the machine takes this effort, and in this way it alleviates the effort of the human operator. I think in the future, especially for civil protection problems of logistics, as well as heavy tasks in the industry, this kind of machine will be strongly developed. The second line of research is related to different environments and augmented reality. In particular, we designed and realized complete, integrated, immersive virtual environment scenarios, in which, in particular, as you can see in the movie, the field of view of the user is completely covered by virtual images. So, from the point of view of visual perception, the user is completely outside the real world. Okay? As you know, the simulated world doesn't exist anywhere inside the computer or in the code. It is only a perceptual experience that is generated in the mind of the user, clearly. And the interesting thing is that the whole system of virtual environments, the whole software architecture is able to generate coherent visual and also other kind of sensory information as acquired from according to the movement or the sensory channels of the human operator. And so in this way, the perceptual experience we try to be coherent. Exactly the whole objective of our lab is that of integrating these two lines of research, in particular by integrating 3D immersive virtual visualization, and also allowing the user to touch, to have a physical contact with the virtual objects. And so this is something that requires different conditions. You will see here the list of the topics that are important in order to achieve a true multi-channel, multi-sensory experience. In particular, here you see a simple explanation of the concept of haptic interaction with virtual environments. To the haptic interface, the user is able to, with his hand, to control the movement of the virtual hand in the virtual environment. And when the virtual hand touches the virtual table, you see the horizontal surface, the system generates a force of contact that is replicated to the user by the interface. In this way, the user is able to perceive the presence of, in this case, a horizontal surface that doesn't exist in reality. So it is possible to generate different kinds of integration. And this is the mechanism that has generated our first idea of what we call the Museum of Pure Form. That is the first project that we had in the field of art and cultural heritage that exploits robotics and the virtual environments for generating different paradigms of interaction with artworks. In particular, this is the concept which has been generated in 1993. Inside the museum, the user is able, through this kind of haptic interfaces, which is worn by his on his arm and on the end, to perceive physically the shape, the 3D shape of a digitalized copy of the sculpture the real sculpture that you can see the original one in the museum. You can see clearly the first activity has been that of digitizing the sculptures. We went in different museums in Europe, in particular here, Museo dell'Opera della Primaziale here in Pisa, Centro Gallego di Arte Contemporanea in Santiago de Compostela, in Galicia, in Spain, the PG Museum in London, UCL, University College London, the National Museum in Stockholm. And you see, in each museum we digitized some example of sculptures, and we have a repository now of 3D sculptures digitized. And here you can see the final installation, which clearly with this kind of robot or with other kind of even desktop systems generating forces at the level of the fingers, the user is able to perceive the shape of the digitized sculptures. This is the installation that we realized at the Museum dell'Opera here in Pisa. We are using here two kinds of robots, one generating forces at the level of the thumb, the second at the index finger. And you can see that with these two fingers, the user is able to control the movement of the two spherical cursors that are touching the sculptures, and is able to perceive different, you see, particulars, shape features of the 3D object that is represented in front of it. This is an example, but clearly, coming back to the general concept of robotics and art, I think that robotics has never acquired such a large media interest like in these last 2 years, you know. This is very important because, but it is something which is not, that doesn't have, didn't happen just for check, you know. It happens because we are working on, a lot of people are working since 50 years in terms of research and industrial development in this field. And now the increase of power in different computer science systems, sensors, different kind of technology allows to perform operations that a few years ago was unbelievable, you know. So you can see here an example of the new types of collaborative robots in industry. You will see the shape of the robot is completely different with respect to the one we are accustomed to see in large premises in the factories. And the interesting thing is how this kind of robot, that are industrial robots, are becoming even more and more collaborative with the human being. This is the famous system, the Baxter, which is developed by Breathing Robotics, and it's possible to, by means of this system, to realize what is called co-working systems, which means robots working with humans. And here you can see how in our project it is possible to an application developed by the group by Professor Avizzano. It is, you can see how the human operator is able to directly teach and show the robot how to behave, which kind of operation is possible to do without, by trying to avoid to program it and by software. Here you can see another example of another category of robots that are extremely important nowadays, and they are receiving large attention also from the media, but also in terms of real application, they are succeeding a lot. In particular, this is the Atlas system developed by Boston Dynamics. after 30 years of research from the Lego robots developed at MIT by Mark Ribert. It is a system that is designed in order to deambulate, to walk, even in, as you will see, in outdoors environments, so unstructured environments. You will see how the balance is automatically achieved by the machine. And you will see it is safe in the sense that it is possible to use this system. Here you can see an example for logistics, and just to mention how you have seen before how humans will be able in the future, already now, to work in strict cooperation with humans. And you can see how this kind of humanoid robots will be able to work directly in contact with humans in a safe way, And the degree of interaction with realistic environments, unstructured environments, is something that provide us extremely good hopes for the future. And you will see how these machines are already working in the same physical space in which the user is working. You can see it is extremely good in performing specific tasks that not all the robots are able to do. This is one of the best examples of humanoid robots existing nowadays in the world. And another kind of robotic systems is what called Android, which is an evolution of it is a cosmetic evolution of robotic technologies. These are the feature, the characteristic of this robot is that of having a cosmetic aspect which is very similar to the human being. And the objective of this kind of research, of the development of this kind of robots, is for the moment different with respect to the one that you have seen before in terms of humanoid robots. Here it is something that can help human for social behavior, for example. But if we move again in the environment of the virtual environment, you can see that there are also now considerable examples of developments in which that are very similar to the development of robotics. In robotics you have seen the development of humanoids and androids. Here you see the development of what are called virtual humans. Virtual humans, there are a lot of examples of virtual humans. And what is interesting is that the cognitive architecture that is controlling virtual humans is very close to the one controlling humanoid robots and androids. Clearly, the research is now pushing towards the control of virtual crowds and social virtual aspects of these systems, in which humans will be able to interact with them. And in the lab, we are working in the framework of virtual environments and augmented reality to develop a mixed reality in which, as you can see, a real person is interacting with virtual humans in specific context that are mixed, a mixture of virtual environments and 3D video registration of human shapes. So we can see that if we analyze the presence condition, the condition of presence from the point of view of the human operator, we are living in a real environment, clearly, where humans are living. we are seeing that robots are living, exoskeletons, humanoid robots, and androids, to the other extreme, you see, of the spectrum. We see that there is the virtual world in which the person is experiencing a scenario which is synthetic, which is generated by the computer, and in which we are seeing that in the future there will be virtual humans. Clearly, in the middle between real environments and virtual environments, conventional reality, let's say, and virtual reality, inside this spectrum we can find conditions of augmented reality or augmented virtuality. And this is something that can be exploited in the future for industrial purposes, but also in art. And what it is interesting to say is that we will be able to conceive not in a very future time, a single pervasive, what is called ubiquitous sense of presence, in which humans, robots, humanoid robots, and virtual humans will share the same complex real digital space. So this is something that provides us a specific frame of reference for the next decade in terms of research development. And so I strongly believe in the what is called transformational value of virtual environments and robotics, the two things connected together. And clearly, we perceive there is a need for a more sophisticated tools for research that are able to modify the content of our subjective experience. And there is the confluence between human, computer, robotics that will bring to deep temporary changes of self-perception. And clearly, I haven't showed the examples of research, but clearly there are experiences in virtual environments and teleoperation, telepresence, in which the point of view of another person can be achieved by the human operator experiencing this condition. It is called that these two kinds of technology can be called technology for empathy studies. And I believe that these tools will be in the future something that could be considered like today computers. You know? We will have virtual environments and robotic systems. And this is something that has been summarized in our research in the topic Understanding the Other, because we believe that these technologies, robotics, virtual environments, can generate new paradigms for the study of the interaction, the study of the needs of the other human beings and among human beings. Well, coming back to the topic after this presentation of our research, we can see that today this kind of pervasive digital technologies like virtual environments, augmented reality and so on can be recognized as artistic media. In particular, the demonstration of the acceptance of these technologies as a form of art has been the organization, for example, of a special track at the Biennale di Venezia, the Venice Virtual Reality Contest, where 18 virtual reality works have participated to the first competition for virtual reality movies. But clearly, if we go back since the beginning of the 19th century, the histories of art and technology have been tightly connected, clearly. Contemporary artists have contributed to develop even new kind of technology. This is an interesting aspect, you know. Artists are able to drive the discoveries of new technologies. In fact, the history of the artistic uses of electronic media is clearly a history that parallels the growing pervasiveness of technology in all aspects of life. Here, for example, you see an example of a work by Olafur Eliasson, also other artists like, for example, James Tarrell, and all have created work that examines the perceptual limits of the human, for example, in this case, visual system. And all artists, like the example of Pakistan Partos in a recent installation, they are using or purposely reusing or invent, as I said before, new electronic media that are able to, let's say, generate new inputs to the sensory systems, in particular, that are able even to baffle the mind. And in this case, this is something that, in my opinion, generate positive effects of what is called the techno culture. It is interesting to take into consideration this powerful definition of the artists, you know, given in 1964 by Marshall McLuhan. And he said, the serious artist is the only person able to encounter technology with intimacy, just because he is an expert aware of the changes in sense perception. So there is no, by the point of view of the artist, there is no danger in using technology. And it is possible, you say, to allow him to have an extreme freedom in developing ideas and artworks. In terms of robotic art, here you can see that each artist explores robotics in particular ways, and usually robots are integrated with other kinds of media, it is interesting also, as I said before, that artists are able to push the limits or even of the technology, even trying to understand what the term robots means, you know, because this is something which, it is something that now goes beyond the generation of a machine, something. And clearly, there are also new aesthetic dimensions in this field, because you are not only generating form, but also there is what is called the aesthetics of generating a specific behavior. And another important aspect is of being able to generate new forms of aesthetical interaction with the user, not only inside the museums, but wherever. Here you can see some examples from now on of systems that are, let's say, at the beginning I show some electromechanical systems that are actuated. This is the one by Jean-Michel Bruyère that has been presented in specific exhibitions. This one has been exhibited in 2014 in Paris. As you see, this is a hospital beds that are breathing and are moving in synchronizing one with the other. This is a famous object, you know, that it is an object of art that it can be morphed from one shape into the other by Chico MacArthur. And here you can see an example of, let's say, the use of robotics that exploits the old paradigm of painting. It is something in which you are using a new technology for an old media, you know, an old way of or achieving the work of art. Here you see the robot is able, through the input of a TV camera, of generating like a sort of plotter specific work of paintings. And you will see here some example. And here there is another work by an artist collective, which is called Robot Lab. It is from Germany. This is two robots. These are two KUKA industrial robots that they act as DJs in order to put records. And the robot actions is very precise, and in order to choose one record and put it on the machine. Here you see some example of this kind of old paradigm use of robots for producing paintings, like you see a very large plotter. And this is another example, a true experiment in which it has been achieved inside the museum, in which a robot in real time, by exploiting the images acquired from a TV camera located on the robot arm, is able to acquire the image and generate. You see the camera on the end effector and on the wrist, on the elbow joint, is able to detect, to acquire the information, the portrait of the girl, and starts to perform this kind of. Clearly, from the software point of view, here there is also some kind of computer vision processing of the image acquired in terms of edge detections and other filters that can be then exploited in order to draw the portrait. And this kind of old paradigm in using robots can be also seen here in this Quaiola sculpture. This is a kind of unfinished object. In particular, here the robot is used like for sculpting materials, in particular this kind of marble material, in which clearly this is used in for artistic purposes. If you go not very far from here in Carrara, inside the caves of Carrara, there are industries that are using for the same purposes this kind of robotic systems. The first example of robots I have to mention, for in which robots are used in terms of telepresence approach, is the one developed by a colleague of mine, in particular Ken Bulger of the University of California, Berkeley, and also Joseph Santaromana from Irvine, UC Irvine, in which you see this adept robot can be controlled from the internet by different people in order to cultivate this kind of little garden. In fact, this installation is called the Tele Garden. Here it is another example in which the use of various technologies, this kind of mobile structure can give the sense of being in another location. There is a camera that is acquiring the movement of the waves of the sea, and the movement of the waves is replicated to this structure. You will see the artist that is fixing the installation inside the museum. You will see this is an actuated structure by this kind of leverages, and the image of the waves acquired far from this location of the museum generates this kind of shape movements in order to replicate the realistic behavior of waves. Another interesting aspect is this one. These are passive mechanics, complex mechanics, that are moved only by the wind. And this is something that is a movable shapes by this is by Theo Janssen. There is also this is the first one of the first examples. Now the sale has been slightly modified in the last version. It is interesting because it is a sort of you know new mechanism, simple new mechanism that generates an effect. Another example is this one by Peter William Holden, in which computers and mechanical components are used to develop movements of this sort of shapes without the heads, you know. And these are, let's say, headless robots, and whose arms are articulated in a synchronized choreographic sequence based on a Kraftwerk music. This is another example by Ken Rinaldo. This is a sort of pieces that involve 10 arachnid creations capable of engaging the audience with, for example, the help of sensors and so on. This is a sort of spiders that work and communicate each other. And this is another installation by the artist Mikami Seiko that set up walls covered with small robotic arms, and there are also sensors and cameras that follow the move of the visitor of the museum, and the images are projected on other walls of the installation. And this is something that has been recently, last year, presented at the Guggenheim in New York. These two Chinese artists have realized this kind of strong industrial robots with this kind of end effector that is, let's say, moving on the floor, in which there is a sort of dark liquid, you know, which shapes is completely modified by the movements of the end effector. And another interesting example is that by this performer artist. Sorry, I don't know how to do it. I can't. This is by Stelak. Stelak is an interesting. Sorry, you have to listen to the video. But this is a kind of exoskeleton, how it is called, in which you see there are 6 pneumatically powered appendages that are worn by the artist, and essentially this is a sort of crawling machine. And it is interesting because Stella has been invited this year by a conference in which I organized in the framework of Rome Europa Festival in Rome at the beginning of December, which is called Where Are We Now? Frames of reference for restoration of the future. Here you can see another example of the art of work by Stelak. Here you see he has attached a robotic arm to the forearm of his right arm. And in this way, it's possible also the performance is that this is called the third hand. The artist held a sheet of paper or is writing on the wall, and with the left hand, and it is exploring the possibility for the third hand to simultaneously write as the other is doing. So this is something that is already something that has been already achieved several years ago. Well, here you can see how robots can be used not exactly in art, but for spectacularization aspects or in fairs and so on. We see how robots can be combined in order to achieve different paradigms for showing digital information. In particular, you see the large structure that contains three industrial robots, and you will see how this kind of movable strings can be exploited in order to achieve specific visual effects for exhibitions. The same concept has been realized in this work, in which robots are exploited in order to, or in this case, combine with the use of these two robots, you see, with two screens that combine and integrate specific images in 3D. You see how the two robots are controlled in order to move the effect of the screens in space. And the interesting thing is that it is possible to show inside the content of the visual. The visual content can be clearly also 3D environments can have that doesn't exist in reality, as you have seen. Well, another interesting aspect, this is the last, not the last, because the state of the art, they are using a larger number of drones, but here Intel is performing this kind of work of art by exploiting 100 drones clearly behavior can be controlled in synchrony with a specific music. And you will see how it appears, the final results of this kind of work. This is a different kind of robots. It's not humanoid or anthropomorphic robots, it's drones. Well, now you will see the program will take into account presentations by different colleagues. Among them is Bill Vaughan and Louis-Philippe de Meyer. And I want to just to tell you that several years ago, 10 years ago, we have invited Bill in the framework of what we call the workshop, Robotics and Art Colloquium 0.1, that we had realized at the Scuola, and that was organized by a small group of people inside the laboratory that are strongly, let's say, pushing towards the integration of art and technology. In order to conclude, I would like to say that robotic art is now assuming an important role in the landscape of new media art. Clearly, it can have different forms. You see, performance installation can be used in dance, theater. I just want to remind you that on Monday, we are organizing another workshop, another conference, especially for animatronics and theaters application of virtual environments. And as you have seen, installations of robotic art can range from non-interactive robotic systems to robot interacting with humans. And the important things to underline is that artists are able even to imagine new uses and new forms of robotics that clearly, from the technological point of view, can be difficult or impossible to conceive. I just want to end my presentation with some words by Olafur Eliasson that say that making a work of art is essentially changing the world. It's not like you are outside the world and then you put the artwork in it. The artwork is a part of the world and it has consequences. It is incredibly important to see that art is actually a part of reality making. I mean, even just a small drawing with a pencil essentially pushes the world. Thank you for your attention. I will leave now the stage to Dr. Lorenzo Blum. Thank you very much.
Proprio vedere, come dire, il lato positivo, l'interazione felice che ci può essere tra arte, soggetto, essere umano e le scoperte scientifiche, quindi l'applicazione del robot. Io forse adesso farò proprio vedere l'altra parte della Luna, il lato oscuro della Luna, ovvero come questa applicazione è stata vista nel corso degli ultimi decenni come in un aspetto diciamo anche inquietante, quindi come artisti hanno osservato anche la parte di pericolosità all'interno di questa totale fiducia tra come dire, le possibilità percettive dell'essere umano e il suo e la potenzializzazione estrema di queste possibilità. La cosa curiosa è che se uno osserva il Novecento, la storia insomma, dell'arte del Novecento, si trova a osservare due grandi cambiamenti. Quali? Se all'inizio del secolo diciamo, i dadaisti, prendiamoli come esempio, durante la Prima Guerra Mondiale, reagiscono a questa grande quindi al Cabinet Voltaire, al Zurigo, reagiscono a questo grande dramma della Prima Guerra Mondiale che loro imputavano come colpa a questa estrema fiducia nelle loro tecnologie, nelle scoperte scientifiche, eccetera, eccetera. Loro reagiscono stabilendo una teoria del caos, una teoria del caso, quindi l'accettazione anche del caso. E quindi possiamo vedere anche nell'immagine uno dei dadaisti, una delle sculture importanti furono esposte anche nelle mostre all'interno del dadaismo, Raoul Hausmann, che presenta questo manichino a cui sono stati applicati vari elementi, tra cui un metodo d'assalto, vari oggetti, proprio per creare una critica all'idea della troppa fiducia nel potenziamento delle possibilità umane attraverso le nuove tecnologie, attraverso la meccanica, insomma, di quel chiamavano, insomma, come loro lo definivano in quegli anni. E oggi invece, quindi, c'è tutta una lunga storia di artisti che si sono confrontati con il tema del corpo, con il tema del corpo che può essere amplificato le sue possibilità attraverso gli strumenti robotici, vedendo questa possibilità sia nell'aspetto positivo sia nell'aspetto appunto negativo, come è evidente nella scultura anche di Hausmann, che dopo, sì, l'uomo può avere tutte le possibilità per poter diventare superuomo, potersi spostare velocemente, poter iniziare ad amplificare le sue potenzialità, ma allo stesso tempo perderà in umanità, ovvero per loro, per i dadaisti, perdere l'umanità voleva dire perdere il contatto con il bene comune, quindi la relazione. Ultimamente, poi si è parlato molto negli anni 90, ne tratterò più avanti, si è parlato molto negli anni 90 sul tema, che era già affrontato anche il professore, su come questo, come il mondo globalizzato dalle nuove tecnologie ha influito sulla percezione da parte del singolo essere umano del suo attorno. Gli artisti in quegli anni, negli anni 90, hanno lavorato molto sul concetto di new media, nel concetto quindi anche di nuovo strumento d'arte, lasciavano le opere d'arte, insomma, di tipo tradizionale e si confrontavano invece con queste nuove tecnologie per comprendere meglio appunto la relazione tra io e il mondo. Recentemente, quindi, questa diciamo questa tendenza degli artisti a riflettere sul potenziamento del corpo umano si è spostato sul tema del potenziamento del paesaggio. Possiamo vedere infatti nell'altra immagine Ito Sterler, un artista di origine asiatica ma che risiede in Germania da tanti anni, che ha rappresentato anche la Germania, il padiglione tedesco alla Biennale Venezia, l'edizione passata due anni fa, dove il suo lavoro è proprio legato a indagare come l'idea dello spazio digitale sta cambiando non solo la percezione del nostro corpo, quindi di chi utilizza questo spazio digitale, ma anche come lo pensa, come pensa anche di gestirlo, come pensa anche di progettarlo. Quindi abbiamo di fronte, come dire, 100 anni di storia. Partiamo dalla nostra storia più recente, ovvero dal dadaismo, quindi la prima guerra mondiale a Zurigo, dove gli artisti da Duchamp, Hans Arp si sono rifugiati dal conflitto e ripensano quindi lì il problema di come appunto viene applicata la nuova tecnologia, e invece le recenti ricerche degli artisti che poi sono state presentate alla Biennale di Berlino un anno fa, con della Biennale di Berlino era proprio il tema del post internet. Abbiamo parlato molto negli ultimi anni di stare, di vivere in una società post-ideologica, post-moderna, con tanti post. Oggi iniziamo a parlare, ci sono tanti dibattiti, gli ultimi due anni sul tema del post-internet. Naturalmente gli scienziati, chi studia anche le neuroscienze, si confronta con questo tema del post-internet semplicemente spiegando che passando da un mondo, 10 anni fa, quando ci confrontavamo con internet alla ricerca di informazione, oggi non ci confrontiamo più con le informazioni che possiamo trovare nel web, ma direttamente con le applicazioni, quindi con piattaforme, quindi con delle mediazioni di informazioni. Questo perché? Molto probabilmente perché si è sviluppato, a parte tutti i motivi economici, di queste tecnologie, perché si è cercato di reagire alla grande apatia che aveva provocato nell'utente, oramai non siamo più esseri umani, siamo utenti, nell'utente la possibilità di poter accedere a tutte le informazioni, proprio l'idea di poter accedere a tutte le informazioni una decina di anni fa ci ha provocato anche l'idea che allora, se uno non sapeva esattamente cosa cercare, non riusciva a trovare niente. La Biennale di Berlino è andata, ha tentato, hanno invitato degli artisti, forse per questo hanno avuto questa libertà di utilizzare questo tema del post internet, hanno voluto concentrare tutto sul tema del post internet, non da questo punto di vista appunto delle applicazioni, ma come tema del come possiamo semplificare del di essere fuori dal di concepire il mondo non più come un'interazione diretta tra tecnologie e realtà, ma concepire la realtà come un tutt'uno con l'immagine digitale con cui abbiamo a che fare oggi. Quindi qui possiamo vedere alcune immagini delle opere che sono state realizzate, dove loro hanno potuto realizzare anche questa biennale un anno fa, anche perché queste tecnologie sono diventate oggi molto, come dire, normali. Tutte noi le salutiamo come oggetti che fanno parte, appunto oggetti che sono informazioni, fanno parte della nostra quotidianità. E solo 10 anni fa sarebbe stato impensabile, perché appunto la percezione delle persone si sarebbe più rivolta al giocattolo, all'oggetto, mentre invece oggi si sono concentrati sull'effetto, come appunto sono abituati nella nostra realtà quotidiana. Ecco, quindi loro hanno messo in mostra appunto il virtuale come reale, le nazioni come marchi, le persone come dati culturali, come capitale. Perché se le persone si mettono in connessione, creano appunto capitale. Oggi noi siamo una società post-internet, forse che non produciamo più oggetti, ma informazioni. Proprio questa capitalizzazione delle informazioni su cui si svolgeranno le prossime diatribe, guerre, tensioni, si stanno già svolgendo. Ecco che questi artisti appunto hanno reagito alla frammentarietà della comunicazione politica, l'algoritmo, quindi l'idea appunto che con Facebook, con le piattaforme sociali abbiamo a che fare non con l'interazione con gli altri, ma proprio con degli algoritmi, con delle formule matematiche. E la Biennale quindi era questa creazione di esperienze in cui mettevano in contatto immagini, l'audience e l'ipotetica realtà con cui potevano dialogare. Martin Heidegger, in un testo famoso di 100 anni prima, sosteneva che l'obiettivo della tecnologia è quello di garantire lo stoccaggio, già insomma aveva cito appunto queste frasi che aveva già individuato. Quello che stavo cercando di descrivere attraverso le immagini della Biennale di, Berlino sul post internet, che l'obiettivo della tecnologia è quello di stoccare la disponibilità delle risorse, portando alle estreme conseguenze questa idea. Dovremmo dire che la tecnologia perfetta è quella che interrompe il flusso del tempo per non disperdere e perdere le risorse. L'obiettivo della tecnologia sembra quello di immunizzare l'uomo contro il cambiamento, di liberare l'uomo dalla sua fisicità, dal destino dell'incidente. Heidegger vede tutto ciò come estremamente pericoloso. La risposta dei dadaisti alla prima guerra mondiale è quella di adottare appunto il caos. Heidegger, molto probabilmente, quando scrive questo testo, aveva ancora nella sua mente ben chiaro questo tipo di reazione anche da parte dei dadaisti. Quindi è curioso che già Heidegger metteva in evidenza una contraddizione, un paradosso, perché noi solitamente siamo abituati a pensare che le applicazioni delle nuove tecnologie servono per creare un balzo in avanti verso il futuro, mentre invece Heidegger aveva ipotizzato questa altra funzione, quella di creare una sorta di sottovuoto, una sorta di difesa contro gli incidenti del tempo, del cambiamento del tempo. Ed è proprio il tema su cui si stanno confrontando gli artisti legati e vogliono lavorare sul tema appunto di come la percezione dell'essere umano cambia con il confronto giornaliero con le nuove tecnologie, con l'idea della smaterializzazione della realtà attraverso la comunicazione globalizzata. In un altro testo, Martin Heidegger, nell'Origine dell'opera d'arte, dice che l'arte è la rivelazione del come noi usiamo le cose. Con la diffusione della tecnologia invece che cosa rivela l'arte? Come noi siamo usati dalle cose. Questo è molto interessante, questo passaggio, che lo vorrei tenere come adesso, come dire, come una sorta di nostra nuvoletta che ci accompagnerà nel vedere le prossime immagini. Qui abbiamo degli artisti che stanno lavorando recentemente sul tema di testo, immagine, riflessione su, appunto, su come noi quindi siamo usati dalle cose in un mondo iperconnesso. Abbiamo John Raffman, un altro artista che appunto è emerso da questa biennale di Berlino, ha lavorato sul tema dell'accumulazione, l'idea degli oggetti, ma se prima c'era l'idea di accumulazione attraverso oggetti fisici, oggi in un mondo smaterializzato come possiamo accumulare queste informazioni, come le possiamo intendere dagli altri? Tra l'altro John Raffman ha fatto un lavoro su questo nuovo schema che è stato diffuso 2 anni fa, un anno e mezzo fa, dei laboratori americani, che indicavano che un fattore per capire la ricchezza delle persone oggi in questo mondo post-ideologico e smaterializzato non è più collegato, non può essere più collegabile, secondo loro, al possesso delle proprietà, al possesso delle cose fisiche, ma nelle loro potenzialità di spostamento, nella loro possibilità di movimentarsi all'interno del globo in maniera, senza implicazioni, senza problemi. Ma facciamo un passo indietro. Questi artisti appunto possono realizzare questi lavori sulla percezione perché proprio la nostra percezione della realtà è cambiata e non vediamo più queste applicazioni come elementi distaccati dal nostro corpo. Il nostro iPhone, il nostro tablet non sono più degli oggetti, sono degli elementi che fanno parte, che camminano con noi, fanno parte del nostro background, non sono esterni a noi, diciamo, è la nostra memoria, insomma, è il nostro modo di comunicare, la nostra lingua. Se facciamo però un passo indietro, negli anni 90, quando ci fu proprio la diffusione, iniziò a diffondersi, insomma, la possibilità di comunicare il mondo attraverso le nuove tecnologie, attraverso internet, ci siamo trovati di fronte a due modalità quasi opposte di applicazione di queste nuove tecnologie. Da una parte abbiamo avuto appunto l'idea della paura per le nuove tecnologie, Franco P, performer, che rendendo naturalmente tutte il background delle conferenze, delle performance degli anni 60 di Hermann Nietzsche, dove lui cercava di esorcizzare l'arrivo delle nuove tecnologie facendo dei lavori sul tema del suo sangue, quindi ciò che lui possedeva lo metteva in mostra, il suo stesso sangue. L'altro caso invece è proprio questa idea dell'arte interattiva, dove gli artisti hanno iniziato a lavorare sull'espansione del proprio corpo, sull'espansione del paesaggio che vivono attraverso i mezzi di riproduzione, che appunto però venivano visti come strumenti esterni alla percezione. Questo passaggio è molto interessante. Negli anni 90, la vera novità appunto di internet è la sua possibilità di ricontestualizzare le informazioni. Questo adesso appunto è una risposta anche che si danno molti artisti sul tema di come controllare, come produrre, creare quindi un archivio, l'unico modo forse è creare questo archivio intoccabile, no? Un artista che ha affrontato in maniera più o meno collega della stessa età di Olaf Eliasson, che citava il professore nella dissertazione precedente, è sicuramente Pierre Wig. Pierwig in questo lavoro famoso, e però è curioso anche proprio il suo percorso, come si è confrontato con la diffusione delle tecnologie. Quando negli anni 2000 ha iniziato a diffondersi questa idea di controllo, di poter essere informati, di poter essere in dialogo con tutti e tutto, ma presente a niente, come diceva Bauman, nella famosa modernità liquida. Pirouig fa un'operazione, come la chiama lui, come la chiama anche Boriot, il critico che ha definito l'arte relazionale, dove possono essere inseriti questi artisti, anche Eliasson, relazionale nel senso che l'opera non esiste in forma a sé stante, ma come dialogo con il contesto, che il contesto è fatto di idee, pubblico e architettura. Lui, la sua operazione qual è? Di comprare un avatar, comprare questa signorina Anne-Li, che ha un progetto di... ha un prodotto, chiamiamo le cose con il loro nome, ha un prodotto fatto da un'industria giapponese che stava sviluppando in quel momento come una serie di personaggi che poi altre industrie potevano comprare e sviluppare o delle pubblicità o dei giochi, soprattutto questo era stato pensato per dei videogiochi. Pierrick compra i diritti, a se non ha altri artisti, di Anne-Li e iniziano a creare delle opere sulla autonomia di Anne-Li. Anne-Li, ad esempio, in questo paesaggio cammina, in questo paesaggio, questo è proprio il lavoro di Pierrick, in questo paesaggio elettronico, e gli viene data uno script che poi attraverso le nuove tecnologie non è mai lo stesso, quindi lo spettatore riceve queste informazioni, lei che recita un monologo che è sempre diverso, perché attraverso i primi esperimenti del computer random permetteva di modificare questo monologo. Il monologo comunque più o meno consisteva sempre nello stesso concetto, nello stesso focus, ovvero io sono un guscio vuoto, sto camminando in questo paesaggio perché nessuno mi dice come riempire il mio guscio, perché nessuno mi dice qual è la mia identità, qual è il mio scopo, scopo non lo utilizza mai come parola, qual è il mio obiettivo, cosa devo fare, ditemi per favore come riempire il mio guscio vuoto. Qui vediamo altre immagini. Dello stesso periodo Pierrick indaga questo tema della, come dire, della appropriazione dell'identità, di come l'identità può cambiare, è fluida, copiando insomma il testo di l'idea di Bauman. Qui è un video che lui realizza sempre nel 2001. Questa signora, che noi non sappiamo chi è, che appunto anche lei recita un monologo, però sicuramente conoscete o avete nella vostra memoria la sua voce. Lei era la voce di Biancaneve, di famoso film animato di Walt Disney, che è famosissima questa voce, appunto, che poi cantava, eccetera, è rimasta insomma nell'immaginario di tutti noi. E lei raccontava la sua storia, ovvero lei era stata rubata la sua identità, lei non poteva più utilizzare la sua voce, aveva firmato un contratto con il signor Disney che da quel momento in poi non poteva più esibirsi nei luoghi pubblici, non poteva più utilizzare la sua voce nei luoghi pubblici. Questo stiamo parlando quindi non di anni recenti, il film della Disney adesso non ricordo di quando è, prossimo agli anni 60 mi sembra. Però naturalmente abbiamo tutti i nostri dispositivi elettronici, quindi Wikipedia ci aiuterà in questo. Ma a parte, quindi gli viene impedito di utilizzare la sua voce, e in questo video con Pierrick per la prima volta racconta tutta questa storia, racconta appunto che lei si è sentita appunto come Anne-Li un guscio vuoto, gli è stata rubata questa identità. Stiamo parlando sempre del 2001, ancora Facebook non era stata diffusa in Europa, non c'era ancora questa percezione del concetto anche di identità fluida, ma cosa ha fatto Facebook alla fine, secondo anche le teorie di Pierrick? Ha reso non problematico cambiare delle informazioni sulla nostra identità, non è più così drammatico, no? Pensate, se uno ripensa anche al famoso libro del del Fumatia Pascal, Pirandello, rifiutarsi di esprimere, di avere, come dire, una coerenza tra l'io e l'identità che uno esprime agli altri era un dramma assoluto. Oggi invece non è poi così drammatico, insomma ci sono tanti livelli. Perché? Perché pensiamo, la scusa è che, perché comunque anche la realtà, ci sono tanti livelli di interazione con il mondo, quindi dipende da quale livello tu vuoi, su cui tu vuoi interagire, e lì ci sarà quel grado di verità che richiede quel tipo di livello. Ecco un altro lavoro di Pierlini, che è sull'idea sempre della spettacolarizzazione, della, che era un tema molto importante negli anni da cavallo tra gli anni 90 e gli anni 2000. Questo era un stage, un palco dove le luci e della nebbia si muovevano creando una danza, dove però questo palco non era né troppo grande né anche troppo piccolo, che dava la sensazione di poter il pubblico entrare all'interno, quindi essere protagonista, ma allo stesso tempo quelle dimensioni, che era un pelino più piccolo per accogliere l'essere umano in una persona, rimaneva comunque fuori dallo spettacolo. Pierluigi poi negli anni, questo è un lavoro che ha realizzato al Castello di Rivoli, sull'idea della, che possiamo raggiungere nel 2006, possiamo raggiungere qualsiasi luogo, lui rese smaterializzata una stanza del Castello di Rivoli, rendendo un pallone volante che poi alla fine della mostra fu riportato, rivestì appunto la stanza stessa. Però la cosa interessante di Pierluigi, di questo percorso, è che negli anni andando avanti, che le nuove tecnologie si sono, come dire, ramificate, sono entrate nella dimensione del quotidiano, diciamo così, del nostro quotidiano, lui è come se si fosse rifiutato di lavorare proprio sulle nuove tecnologie. Si è quindi concentrato sull'idea di un nuovo tipo di approccio, che è quello dell'archeologia, la dimensione archeologica, quindi si è rivolto al mondo biologico. Questo è un lavoro, un'immagine, un lavoro recente, l'ho realizzato a Münster, in Germania, che è un paesino dove ogni 10 anni c'è una mostra molto importante di opere pubbliche, che alcune dopo vengono adottate dalla città e rimangono in maniera permanente lì. Lui in pratica ha scavato, questo era la pista di pattinaggio della città pubblica, che poi è rimasta inservibile, dove lui ha praticato con nuove tecnologie che però non vediamo presenti, con questi raggi laser, con varie tipi di nuove tecnologie, insomma, utilizzate dalla NASA, per tagliare il pavimento e riscoprire quindi la realtà biologica. C'è poi in cima, vedete, c'è il soffitto che si apre e si chiude a seconda della temperatura esterna, per avere lo stesso livello di temperatura esterna e permettere quindi alla nuova vita, vedete il termitaio, che non è una scultura, è proprio questa nuova scultura fatta dalle formiche, quindi work in progress. Ha realizzato poi anche un altro lavoro a Documenta Cassel 2 anni fa, 5 anni fa, nel 2012, proprio su questa idea di laboratorio in un parco dove vita organica e vita inorganica andavano a incontrarsi, ma soprattutto c'erano vari elementi che facevano parte di questa un'immagine di questa opera. Cioè lui, Pierluigi, con questo lavoro ha cercato di stimolare la percezione dello spettatore, quindi tutti ci dovevamo chiedere se il cane che si aggirava all'interno di questo spazio, se la scultura antica la cui testa era ricoperta dalle api, se questi oggetti di pietra lasciati lì come in attesa di essere usati per costruire chissà cosa, facesse parte dell'opera o facesse parte invece di una cosa casuale che era stata abbandonata lì. Proprio lavorare adesso sul tema del between, di stare nel mezzo tra il progetto e il risultato è la risposta che Federica sta adottando negli ultimi 5 anni per riflettere su come le nuove tecnologie stanno cambiando il nostro modo di vedere le cose. Sul tema del potenziamento del paesaggio, appunto l'ho citato all'inizio, possiamo avere appunto due casi, poi mi interrompo, non ho preso il tempo, non so quanto, ok, ma altri 5 minuti. Ito Sterle, ad esempio, lei ha realizzato questa grande installazione dove nelle immagini, questi monitor, ha preso da internet le simulazioni, come prima ci aveva fatto vedere anche il professore, simulazioni di laboratori in Giappone e in America con cui si interagivano, come dire, sperimentavano nei robot la loro capacità motoria, la loro capacità di interagire con il mondo. Quindi interagire, come diceva anche il professore prima, vuol dire anche reagire al caso, all'imprevisto. In questa immagine, quindi, da una parte ha messo questo video che con un suo testo, sono molto importanti in questi suoi video la voce narrante che ci fa un po' da collegamento in questi archivi, in queste immagini che possiamo trovare ovunque, però non sappiamo come metterle assieme. E invece in un'altra parte, sempre di questa mostra, c'era forse il lavoro più curioso e inquietante, ovvero utilizzando una nuova tecnologia di Google Map che ancora non è stata diffusa, è un drone. Lei dirigeva questo drone nelle strade di una cittadina dell'Iraq, con varie, quindi distrutta dai vari bombardamenti della guerra, dove il drone cercava di tradurre quello che si trovava di fronte. Quindi diceva: questo qui è nella traduzione, che appunto era una tecnologia sperimentale, cercava di migliorarsi, fino ad arrivare a dire a un certo punto, prima diceva, vedeva questa casa distrutta, diceva il numero 17, c'è una famiglia composta da, e diceva i nomi. Quello però era prima che arrivasse la bomba e distruggesse tutto, quindi doveva reinventare la sua interazione con la realtà, fino a dire a un certo punto luogo non ben identificato, distrutto dal caso. Questo è molto curioso, che appunto le bombe sono casuali, secondo il drone, secondo queste nuove tecnologie. Ecco, vediamo queste immagini. Questo testo appunto fa parte, che prende la forma di parole luminose, come appunto i nostri schermi retroilluminati, che possono diventare dei luoghi da praticare. Quindi l'opera in questo caso non è tanto l'utilizzo delle nuove tecnologie, ma vedere come possono essere ripensate come collettività, ed è quindi che ha creato in maniera anche curiosa un'idea di piazza. Una piazza non però virtuale, una piazza fisica dove le persone possono prendere posizione. Infatti parte del lavoro sono proprio anche gli incontri che vengono fatti all'interno di questa piazza, dove le persone possono mettersi su queste parole per ragionare proprio sull'utilizzo delle nuove tecnologie e delle interazioni con i robot. Qui abbiamo delle immagini del padiglione che ha rappresentato il tedesco, quando era presentato la Germania 2 anni fa alla Biennale di Venezia, dove appunto anche qui in questo caso l'idea della realtà virtuale e del potenziamento dello spazio, la nostra interazione con lo spazio, diventava una sorta di immagine archeologica con queste sedie degli anni 70 e questi LED luminosi che creavano appunto i primi sistemi dei computer degli anni 70. Con poi c'era proprio tutto un testo appunto che spiegava che aveva messo in relazione varie comunità che in rete giocano a dei videogiochi e che loro sono una vera e propria comunità, ma che appunto interagiscono attraverso queste simulazioni dei giochi. Ecco qua altri casi, ed ecco uno dei video del 2015 di Postelle, che lei realizza una sorta di lecture in cui appunto dice io nello, si confronta con l'idea di Photoshop, dice da quando esiste il Photoshop tutti siamo artisti, però se tutti siamo artisti allora chi è l'artista? Perché se tutti siamo artisti vuol dire tutti possiamo capire, prendendo anche la famosa frase di Beuys, tutti possiamo capire l'arte, ma a quel punto a chi la, per chi la produciamo, a chi è destinata, chi è il nostro audience, diciamo? Un altro lavoro molto importante in questo caso è di Camille Roth, che sempre nel 2013 nella Biennale di Venezia, curata da Massimiliano Gioni, ha vinto il Leone d'argento per il miglior lavoro. Questo è un video dove si chiama appunto La grossa fatica, è il titolo del lavoro, dove in una sorta di lecture lei fa, crea una performance dove in un tempo ben preciso che lei si è costretta a utilizzare mostra tutta la storia dell'umanità, mettendo assieme appunto le prime immagini della biologia, ma utilizzando naturalmente la sintesi di questa storia dell'umanità, quindi Wikipedia e altri motori di ricerca di questo tipo. Alla fine abbiamo un, utilizzando le migliori tecnologie dello, della simulazione, quindi questa immagine è come un mago che tira fuori dal cappello l'immagine in 3D e poi c'è l'immagine della scultura del neolitico che può essere vista da tutti i punti di vista. La cosa interessante di questo lavoro è che proprio nell'andare avanti, nella spiegazione, nel dare voce a tutte queste informazioni, si ferma, c'è il colpo di tosse, si rallenta, la tecnologia si ferma, non riesce a, da un certo punto il 3D che rappresenta un cucciolo di dinosauro, un cucciolo di dinosauro si inceppa, diciamo, non è più fluida, proprio in questo fluidità del problema della non fluidità di questi dati di informazioni che i Postelle, che Camille Roth va a individuare anche la parte, diciamo, più nascosta, anche più inquietante del nostro rapporto con le nuove tecnologie. Quindi possiamo dire che quello che accomuna queste due artiste, che non si confrontano più con il potenziamento del corpo dell'essere umano, perché le nuove tecnologie ci hanno permesso appunto di avere un controllo del paesaggio, quello che accomuna nella loro riflessione è che un approccio appunto di uno scritto catalogatorio che tende al metodo archeologico, ma rispetto al computer per usare appunto il delirio catalogatorio di cui parlava Walter Benjamin. Questo delirio catalogatorio di Benjamin appunto era l'idea di a un certo punto si doveva fermare, perché nell'accumulare poi uno doveva scegliere prima o poi nella propria casa di cosa abbandonare. In questo caso invece i Postelle e Camille Roth si rendono conto che in questo spazio espanso di internet possiamo accumulare per sempre, ma come poi possiamo ripensare questo, questa informazione? Questa è la vera domanda delle ossessioni, che ci dovrebbe ossessionare anche a noi. Poi delle nuove tecnologie sono interessate loro due al flusso di informazione che trasmette fiducia, ma appunto al primo errore di connessione emerge in maniera preponderante la sensazione di solitudine e fallimento. Quindi loro mettono in mostra anche questa dimensione di inquietudine forte. Il terzo elemento è utilizzano tutti i new media, ma affermano che non gli interessa la tecnologia in sé, bensì l'emozione e la mitologia. Loro parlano di un nuovo lirismo magico organico, che in effetti ritroviamo anche questa idea della nuova mitologia del mondo biologico, ritroviamo anche, ritroviamo anche nel lavoro di Puerig. Quindi il tema del narratore che ci guida nel paesaggio potenziato del mondo digitale è un tema forse centrale di come gli artisti cercano l'altra, diciamo, dark side, l'altra parte degli artisti che della luna oscura, della parte oscura della luna, che cercano di indagare come l'uomo interagisce con le nuove tecnologie. Il tema del narratore è molto importante, e osservano come le nuove tecnologie di massa siano gli strumenti perfetti per le sette religiose o l'esercito per creare interazioni con il reale e il proselitismo. quindi c'è anche questa idea di essere in contatto con tutti e tutto, questa idea di cambiare l'identità che può permettere proprio questa idea di malleabilità delle nuove tecnologie, del nostro muoverci senza più con questi strumenti che non percepiamo più come degli strumenti, per creare appunto una nuova idea di comunità. Questa comunità, quindi il proselitismo e l'utilizzo e l'applicazione anche dell'esercito di cui parlano Ito Sterle e Camille Roth, la vera domanda che noi ci dobbiamo porre è perché possono forzare su questo tipo di proselitismo. Forse perché appunto manca uno spazio di interazione, uno spazio di confronto reale tra non solo tra io e gli altri, ma anche tra io e come trasmettere tutto questo sapere che noi oggi abbiamo alla portata di mano. Grazie.
Telling me I need to adjust my volume, but what he was describing there was the sort of ability of the brain to kind of reconcile and fill in the blanks, right? Fill in all the information and the ping pong balls acquire kind of animacy. So there's a vast difference between the technological sophistication of a ping pong ball and an advanced research robot like the PR2. But both are material objects that trigger our mental participation. And they're each involved in their own way in a performance of liveness. And movement can prompt us to perceive and attribute agency and intentionality, even momentarily, to non-living objects. And this connection between puppetry and robots was articulated very clearly by Fiammetta Ghedini and Professore Bergamasco in their essay on anthropomorphism and interaction in contemporary art. Noting the proliferation of robotic creatures in visual arts, they define a paradox of robot performance, where robots simultaneously occlude and expose their artificiality. Quote, puppets challenge the audience's understanding of objects and life, and question a complex relation with acting non-living beings. This issue is crucial to our technology-oriented society. Indeed, studies demonstrate that our relationship with machines is both natural and social, and our brain mechanisms evoke empathy, trust, uncanniness towards an assembly of circuits or mechanical pieces. A technological object can suspend our disbelief, just as would a literary character, or indeed a puppet. End quote. And as we've already seen some examples of and will continue to hear, that artists working with robots can explore this paradox by asking us to look beyond the skin of objects and directing our attention towards the relation between objects, people, and environments. In works such as Louis-Philippe de Maistre's Tiller Girls, pictured here, this relation is manifest through the choreographed and sometimes unpredictable movements of a chorus of robot dancers. So the link between robots and art goes back centuries, when engineers like Hiro of Alexandria and Ismail al-Jassari developed mechanical devices and small toy theaters powered by pneumatics and hydraulics. Across the world and throughout history, artists have experimented with mechanisms to create autonomous creatures that simulate human and animal life. These spectacular machines continue to delight and mesmerize audience with increasing technological sophistication. Sometimes these objects look strange and mechanical, and other times they surprise us with their uncanny resemblance to humans. In productions like Orisa Hirata's Sayonara and Metamorphosis, the android version, robots and humanoids occupy the same physical space, embodying the psychological realism of human characters in scripted dramas. In these theatrical productions, robots function as cultural symbols of a technological future where humans and robots interact, asking audiences to consider the ethical and societal impact of robots in the future. The robots function as metaphorical humans, and the plays draw on narrative tropes that are familiar to science fiction, film, and literary fiction. But at other times, robot technologies afford mechanical possibilities and the realization of larger-than-life, fantastical creatures that have hitherto only been imagined on screen. Creature Technology Company combines traditional puppetry with state-of-the-art animatronics, and it sounds like we'll hear more about animatronics on stage tomorrow. Their 2013 production of King Kong featured a 6-meter-tall, 1.1-ton robotic marionette, operated by 16 microprocessors and a team of 13 puppeteers, who work in concert with offstage puppeteers to control the facial movements and the voice. And I'll show you a short clip. I'll need some volume for this. It's theater, right? Well, we'll see you. personal, but the hybrid technique where you've got humans collaborating and controlling together with kind of automation, control, traditional marionette puppetry, I think proposes not only a new paradigm for entertainment robots, but also a new paradigm for modeling and understanding human-robot interaction and teleoperation. Flugvendet Lisa is a Danish company. Their 2014 production of Fremtiden, or the future, takes a different approach. The play features two industrial high-payload KUKA robots that communicate principally through pre-planned choreography and occasionally recorded voiceovers. The robots are examples of what performance studies scholar Jennifer Parker Starbuck calls subject technologies. In performance, the robots transcend their status as functional machines and become performers by enacting nearly 20 different characters over the course of the play, from a small child in a rural African village to a robotic personal assistant. But unlike humanoid robots, the robots are not seen as proxies for humans, but rather as versatile performers, agents capable of transforming characters without changing their outward form. Our perception of the robots may change based on the context of the script, but we never stop seeing them for what they are: large, powerful, and potentially very dangerous industrial machines. Machine actors such as these, and we've seen examples of many other industrial robots on stage, are shifting, they dramatize the contemporary shift in the cultural function of robots in society, from industrial machines towards robots as social actors and collaborative agents that work alongside humans. So for the past 10 years, I've been documenting robots in performance, and I've been trying to understand the different approaches and to design and to control that they employ. I'm interested in how robots are animated and the dramaturgy and the choreography that goes into developing these performances. And I'm also convinced that live performance is an ideal site for conducting tractable human-robot interaction research. So in the next part of my talk, I'd like to shift a bit and show some examples of work that I think are really quite novel in their approaches to choreography. They aren't scripted dramas or performances like Ping Pong, but rather they're more interactive performances that are focusing on relationality and interactivity. And we'll hear later from Phil and Louis Philippe, who are not only pioneers, but I would even say the sort of founders of this field of robot performance. Their highly original performances challenge the audience by doing exactly what you suggested. They're exploiting new but sometimes troubling and subversive relationships between humans and machines. Unlike pre-programmed robot actors, their robots are reactive and respond to input from the performers or audiences, creating a unique atmosphere for exploring nuanced and diverse relationships and interactions between people and machines. And I'll start with a piece by Aksha Khera and Dan Fang's Trespass. This is a project at the Bartlett School of Architecture at the University College London. They've got a new program there on robots, architecture, and performance. Evidence that the performance is live or interactive and not prescripted. And generally, this is a problem for robotic performance. It's very, very difficult for an audience to tell whether something is pre-programmed or whether it's happening live based on real-time interactions. And I go back and forth about whether or not this is actually an important thing for the audience to know, to be clued into the fact. But maybe that's the mystery of theater performance. But what's certainly true from this example, this performance, is both the performer and the audience become more consciously aware of their own bodies. And they become highly perceptive of their own motion and the relation of their bodies to other bodies in motion. And this work invites a new spatial experience, not only for the performer interacting with the robot, but also with everybody who potentially the audience that would be in this gallery or installation. And for an indication of how this might work in a performance or gallery context, we can look back a few years at a piece by Rory Glynn, his 2011 collection at, or installation rather, called Motive Colloquies, The Promise of Touch. In this site-specific performance, a reactive Delta robot performed at the Pompidou Center in a gallery that contained Francis Bacon's The Three Figures in a Room and Picasso's Femme devant la mer, and you'll see them in the background of this video. Perception of liveness. And it also might be a useful method for discussing discovering new approaches to choreographic motion and can stimulate new choreographic techniques or approaches for dancers. So I'll show you videos of the lab and then a video of the performance, and we did perform in front of a live audience because I think that's absolutely necessary and crucial. But I want to emphasize that I don't see the performance as the end result. I see performance and working towards a performance as an experimental method for adapting process-oriented approaches like choreography for studying human-robot interaction and perception. We use a bottom-up approach, beginning by exploring the most basic patterns of movement and mimetic behaviors. So how to abstract behaviors into simple motion commands for robots based on input from the dancers. Unlike the other examples we've seen, we're working with a mobile robot. And this is both an advantage and a hindrance. We avoid the trap that the robot will be perceived as some sort of metaphorical human, and instead prompts the dancer to interact according to spatial awareness and orientation. However, the range of movement is extremely limited, and you'll note that. The robot can only move horizontally, tracing a path along the floor and varying its speed. Limited to the proximic movement and lacking the capabilities for expressive gesture, the robot is limited to sort of these behaviors of following, mirroring, repeating, and circling the dancer with minor adjustments in speed and direction. And at the beginning of, I used to teach improvisational acting for actors and for dancers, and these are kind of the basic building blocks of improvisation when you start learning, just learning to direct motion and follow. But despite these relatively basic motions, a wide range of interesting spatial arrangements and coordinated action sequences emerged from these very pedestrian behaviors. And stillness also became an important action. Alternating moments of stillness between the dancer and the robot creates some poetic moments where even the dancer became confused about who was leading and who was following. And we wanted to come up with an algorithm that, or some sketches and an algorithm that would be versatile, right? So we're not interested in pre-programmed choreography. And to test it, we decided to work with three dancers working with three completely different paradigms. So we worked with a physical theater actor, a breakdancer, and a modern dancer. And it's really quite interesting to see what happened. The motion algorithm was identical. We would invite them into the lab, and we would have them just interact, give them very little information about how the robot was programmed and what it was doing. And we saw that each dancer, with their different dance form, elicited a unique set of behaviors and some unexpected motions. And I'll give you a little indication of this. This is Miguel, who's building exoskeletons for a living and modeling the human body. He's also a hobby for dancing.
Thank you.
to continue this work further and start to work with some machine learning so that we can refine the algorithm and the robot can actually become a more capable dance partner. But everything here was improvised. This was only the third time the dancer had ever seen or interacted with the robot. And the musicians had never met the dancer or the robot. So I really like this aspect of improvisation as an investigative tool, as a method for exploring human-robot interaction. So the last project that I'm working on, and unfortunately I don't have a video to show you, just a couple of still images, but we're actually working with Baxter. I'm working with a team of researchers from the University of Canberra, Dan Karath, and my team at Aalborg University on the RAP Lab, Robots, Art, People, and Performance. It's an exploratory study on HRI, and we're working with dancers and visual artists, puppeteers and choreographers, and we're developing movement workshops that explore artistic movement potential of manufacturing robots. Dancers and choreographers have really different expectations about how to relate to machines. And these machines were designed with very different purposes in mind. So in a series of public workshops, we do the private workshops with the dancers and the choreographers, and then we invite the public in, and we invite them in to come in and participate in these hands-on workshops that lead to kind of promote physical participation and interaction through touch and creative movement. Now, neither the Baxter nor the wheeled robot that I showed you in the Dynamic Still project are particularly interesting from an aesthetic standpoint, right? But I do think that their forms, their outward forms, are really akin to the kind of robots that we might encounter in the future, and in domestic environments and in service environments. So these sort of clunky robots that are dexterous, stationary, manufacturing arms, these are robots too that will be in our environments. Wouldn't it be amazing if they could move with the grace and agility of humans and dancers? That's an idea I'm excited about exploring. And I'm not the only one. I just learned of an exhibition that opens next week at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. This production is called Slave Master, and it's a performance installation that combines dance, industrial robotic arms, also KUKA robots, with interactive projection graphics. And the interesting thing about this work is that it's not the work of an artist, but it's the work of an ad agency, the VR Innovation Agency. And they collaborated with dancers from the London Contemporary Ballet and put together this team to explore a mood, the mood of collaborative robots working together with humans. And the project is aiming, through performance, to kind of reverse the trope of science fiction films, where robots are scary and oppressive, and to create a physical dialogue between people and machines. They're interested in challenging the public's perception of robots, and to make them more accessible, less daunting. I haven't seen it yet, but it looks like these kinds of experiments where you've got sort of robots dancing alongside humans, it's not quite collaborative yet. I'm still pretty skeptical whether or not we can call this collaboration. It looks to me more like a parallel performance. And the interaction is also limited because, again, the audience is not involved yet. But these performances, I think, raise really interesting possibilities about how researchers and artists can come together to refine their understanding of this shared corporal spaces and the interaction between the human perception of movement and spatiality. So I just saw these. Has anyone seen these yet? Have you seen these delivery robots? These are the Starship technologies, the alternative to the drones, so we're going to be delivering our packages. It hit the news recently. But our physical world is increasingly populated by intelligent, mobile, mechanical devices. We have to learn, and we will learn, to negotiate physical space and to trust these robots in our midst. And we will become aware of these new robot bodies, our own bodies in space, and also the new kinds of spaces and augmented spaces that we occupy. I think artists can really help shape this world by developing nuanced responses and complex interactions between people and machines. So thank you for your time, and I'd like to thank my collaborators for my work.
thank you very much to all of you for coming by this lovely morning. Thank you to Massimo for inviting us at the festival. So my presentation this morning will be mostly about my work in robotic art. And also because Louis-Philippe, who is presenting after me, like we worked together for like many years during the 90s, and recently we also worked together on a collaborative piece. Maybe sometimes there will be some crossovers. But in any case, I'll go by chronological order from the older piece to the more recent work. So I started to work with machines and robots 25 years ago, at the beginning of the 90s. But before that, I was a musician and sound editor, making mostly music and audio work during the 80s. And maybe I can say that at the time I was working mostly with electronic music, electronic pop music, music for film, and I was never really like a real musician, like an academician. I learned music just by making it, and it was made possible by, you know, using what was called at the time the home computer to be able to create a music piece or composing music piece. Not from a very musical perspective, but I would say more from a montage type of perspective, where you edit things, whatever it is, like sound objects or samples or sound instruments, in order to create a larger piece. So that's, you know, my background. And I was not a also a musician, an engineer. I did my studies in communication, so I studied media, and I got interested in using technology as a way to make art by trying different things, trying different mediums of expression. But it's only at the beginning of the 90s when I met Louis-Philippe that, you know, like this idea of using machines to create audiovisual spectacle came together. As I was coming from the audio world, the music world, and Louis-Philippe was coming more from the stage lighting area, we were kind of wondering together, like, how can we animate sound and light and space to create something interesting. So we came to this not from an engineer perspective, where we were interested like only in the object that we would be making, but from really from a sort of a spectacle, theatrical intention, where we really were into creating a large-scale environment that would incorporate those robots. So it was not about the object, but about the whole setup, the whole scene that we were creating. So our first project, called Espace Vectoriel, we in fact replicated the same unit many times in order to create choreographies, or sometimes to create like individual robotic entities that were like sort of reacting to the presence of the viewers and following these viewers in space by the use of sensors and things like that. So just to give you an idea, each of these different tubes, there were like 8 robotic tubes in the installations, and each of them was about 1 meter long, and was able to project sound and light on an individual basis. So it was possible to control them as a group or as an individual. This was also a little bit inspired by what was popular at the time, like the emergence of the discipline of artificial life, which was sort of a discipline made of multiple disciplines, and building complexity by adding multiple simple units. So we started our first project, in fact, were based on these ideas. And the Stocks Victoria was one of them. It was also a work that kind of was really much built around creating impressions on the viewers. So we always had the perspective where we were wondering what kind of effect can we create on the viewers and on the people who are in front of this. So it was not only about making machines that have some kind of incredible abilities or spectacular potential or making something incredible in front of the viewer, but also creating some kind of impression, so to make them feel something different in front of these objects, make them feel also somewhere else in a world that's kind of belong only to these objects. The second piece that we made, not so long after the first, was also based on the same idea. It was called the Frenchman Lake, but that had nothing to do with the French language or France. It was simply inspired by the place in the desert, Nevada desert, where they did the nuclear tests a long time ago. And in fact, we wanted to create an underwater installation for machines, but that didn't turn out very well because water and electricity doesn't go very well together. And we had some leaks problem, of course. So we simply used the same machines to create a piece that functioned exactly like Espace Victoria, so it was the replication of the same audiovisual robotic machines reacting to the presence of viewers with, in this case, a different type of sensor, but it was the same idea. So in this installation, we were able to create complex rhythms, complex sound textures, because each of the robots had a different sound source, so it was creating a big sound specialization system at the same time. This is a close-up to one of these different units. Each one of them also had a lot of lighting effect, strobe lights and halogen lights. Things like that. But a few years after, it started to change dramatically, or we shifted from this idea of replication, and we sort of developed a new approach where we built many different species of machines rather than just creating or replicating the same things over and over. So in this case, it became the world of machines that we were creating was becoming more complex because we had machines that were able to be different from one to the other and behave also differently. So this installation was called No Man's Land. And we made machines that were really based on the way on behaviors that they had that were kind of very different from what you would expect from normal machines. For example, the one I showed before, this one's called the crawling machine. So that was a machine that was simply on the floor and trying to move around, but with some kind of difficulty because it was really sort of crawling with its arms on the floor. So these are other images from this installation. And just a year after, we built this other piece with previous machines that we made for No Man's Land, and also adding up new ones. And this time we had a working team that was based on the human condition, so we called it the misery of the machines. And all the robots in La Cour des Miracles, they were also from different species, but they were built according to the type of misbehavior or the, like the sort of subverted behaviors that they had, but that corresponded to some kind of misery that we can project onto these entities. So we build a large-scale environment. Here we have an example of how it looked like. In fact, this is a recent version that we did of this show. And we built different machines that express different things, like the convalescent machine, for example, who was simply shaking on the floor as it was responding to proximity or presence of the viewers nearby. And also, once again, all these different machines, the different robots, had a way to express themselves through audio. They all had a sound source, a speaker, and I would say some kind of vocabulary of different sounds that they could express depending of what was going on. Same thing for the limping machine, which was in fact a machine that never really walked. It was supposed to be walking with difficulty, but we just flipped it on its back and it turned out to be a very poetic machine, having some kind of, being some kind of helplessly trying to get up on its feet. But of course, always failing. The begging machine was a machine that was simply begging for money, using a vacuum cleaner to absorb cash or money through its digestive system. Harassing machine was simply harassing the viewers as they passed by, and so on. So we made a few of these different species. At the same time, as I was interested by the idea of artificial life at the time, and there were a lot of screensavers using the game of life and cellular automatons to express ALAF principles, I just wanted to make my own as a giant scale cellular automaton using strong light bulbs and a big structure to replicate this effect. So my idea was just to create something that was in your face with something that is usually just a plain computer screen, sort of animated graphic. So it's an evolving visual pattern generated by computer rules. And finally, Louis-Philippe and I developed Le Procès, which was also another work where we created different types of machine, but this one was more in the context of a performance. In fact, it has even been integrated into a theater play at the time by a famous Canadian scenographer. But this theater play didn't last for long, and in fact, the robotic component that we added to the play didn't really add anything very special, because there was no relationship with this play. So we took these robots out of the theatrical play, and we just toured it by our own. So we came up with these large-scale machines, and we installed them at some point in like these images that show this place in a middle-aged church. So we filled the church with robots, like in this case. So it was like a huge space, completely full with machines. And once again, the idea behind that was really to create an environment and treating this environment as a robot. So it's not only the machines as actor in the play or in the space, but also as the whole play being a world in itself and controlled as a system. So after that, I created my first kind of anthropomorphic work. So you see that it moved from very abstract forms and shapes that we developed at the beginning of the 90s to something more and more zoomorphic and more anthropomorphic afterwards. So this piece called Stead was sort of my first attempt as creating something anthropomorphic, but once again, it was also sitting on top of an abstract silver automaton generated with revolving little motors and a video projection on top. And I also did a collaborative work with Simon Penny from UC Irvine, which was a telerobotic installation where we built two identical robots using also two identical motion tracking systems that were installed at two remote locations. And we linked them by the internet, so it was possible for the viewers at one location to control or to trigger different behaviors from the robot at the other remote location. But it was a very complex project integrating a lot of elements. For example, there were some sound agents, like sound sources with specific sounds orbiting around the viewers who were entering the 3D 3D model generator that was tracking the motion of the viewer. So it was at some point a bit difficult for the viewers to understand what was going on. But it allowed us to develop different technologies relating to IP control. I did a work that was a commission by the Science Center in Montreal that was based on a show that we're doing on the principle of rotation. So they asked me to create some kind of example of what it could be for a robot to integrate many different principles, not only revolving, but also like the lever principles and things like that. So I created those five suspended robots, which were, of course, spinning, but also going up and down, and each one of them had a revolving camera, so they were able to track what was going on. And as they were displays, at the same time, people were enjoying being watched by the robots, or were enjoying looking at what the robot was looking. So it was also the pre-selfie era. Red light that created after was sort of also based on the same idea, like machines are also reacting to the presence of the viewers. In this case, what was different is that I didn't use any ready-made industrial parts as motors, but I developed my own artificial muscles. Like an artificial muscle is simply a latex tube or silicone tube that when you inflate it with compressed air, it contracts. It doesn't contract too much, but it contracts like a muscle. So what I did is that I just aligned them in a series along these kind of tentacle structures, and it really sort of gave an arm-like type of motion to the structure. And at the same time, it was very organic because it was more fluid than what you can achieve with normal metal pneumatic pistons. I started to work on hysterical machines, in fact, way earlier than 2006, on a prototype that eventually I renamed the pre-hysterical machine. But it's really in 2006 that I ended up with working more seriously on this project. I think this. For me, that was a project that followed very well the La Cour des Miracles that we did in 97, because it was still using the principle or the idea of machine misery, or how can machine be miserable somehow. And in this case, it was for me, it was to make a machine that react more or less hysterically, depending of how close or how many people are standing around the robot. So I should say that, no, it doesn't, maybe it's not obvious in these photographs, but there is never any kind of frontier or barrier or anything to stop the viewers to be more or less close to these robots. People can approach the machine and touch them if they want, although that doesn't really happen very often. So it's really about creating a relationship with the viewers. So people are invited into the environment, they're invited to sort of explore it, and also they're invited to sort of approach and start having a certain relationship with these machines. So with the historical machine, I ended up experimenting with a lot of different things. Like in this case here, you see little lasers installed on the robot. And this shows also another reason why we try to use as many theatrical devices and effects that we can, especially smoke. Because with smoke, it's not because it looks like a discotheque, but it's more because you can really start seeing the light beams that are projected by the light source on the robots. And these light beams, they become some kind of a virtual extension of the machine. So not only you can, you have a moving object in front of you, but this object has a totally new dimension because of these virtual extensions. And finally, at the end of, around 2010, I would say, I built my own King Kong machine. With this one called the Mega Hysterical Machine. So it was exactly the same model, if you want, as the normal, the ordinary hysterical machine. And but it was a child one, so it was about 8 times larger in all the dimensions, so the 4 meter wide in terms of arm span. And for me, it was just a way to be able to, you know, close the file and, you know, start something else. And this robot, in fact, was never really considered as being aesthetical because it was he was moving in a very slow way. Otherwise, it would have then become too dangerous for people to stand beside it. Or I would have been obliged to install some kind of barrier, which I didn't want it to be. So also during the year 2000, I started to explore other things, like the relationship between the performer and the machine. So it was, for me, very different because it didn't involve the viewers anymore. It was more traditional in a way because the viewer was standing further away from what was going on. But the dialogue became something between someone who is more aware of what's going on, the performer, and the robot. For Graystake Machine, which was the name of the piece, I developed a specific type of robot, which was kind of very abstract, but was able to adapt many kind of shapes, some kind of a sort of expanding, retracting type of structure, made of multiple Stewart platform. A Stewart platform is simply the same principle that we use for flight simulators. So I ended up creating those abstract machines that were reacting to different things that the performer was doing. Because she was wearing a motion tracking device, and the different movement that she was doing was triggering different responses from the robot. Most of the time it was totally improvised, but sometimes, of course, we had some predetermined, pre-programmed, choreographed sections in the piece. I also tried something very different with this work called Pas de Chasse, which was an hybrid sculpture robotic type of work. I use a standard industrial robot arm on which I installed a cast moose head in aluminum. And in this case, it was sometimes presented as an automaton, just simply repeating the same line of movement, or, like in this other case here, as a reactive robot by using a sound location device that is based on multiple microphones, able to pick up a sound source in space and determine exactly where this sound source was located. So that was controlling the height and the angle of the robot, so the moose was kind of turning towards whoever was speaking in the room. And a bit later, I came up with this other project called DSM-6, which was based on the DSM-4. At the time, it was the Bible of American psychiatry, describing all the different human mental disorders. So my idea was just to project myself a little bit in the future and see how machines can also have their own little mental problems. I didn't want to replicate the entire dictionary of mental problems, but I just want to illustrate it by showing different potential of these problems. And this is something that always was behind most of the work I did, and also we should do this, to show machines not as being perfect entities or sort of projection of better human stronger humans, more perfect humans that we are, but also as projections of all our, the, you know, our own human condition and all the problems and what makes us human. So mental disorders is one of them, and that's what I wanted to show with DSM-6. So right now we have the DSM-5 that came out not so long ago, and in fact it means that the DSM-6 is not too far away in the future. This machine here is something that finally, it didn't add really any name at the beginning, but it really turned out very quickly in being an autistic machine, because it had a way to recognize if there was somebody or not in front of it. It had a face tracking system, and what it did in terms of behavior is that each time it recognized a human, it sort of shied away from it. You know, it just turned around and tried not to look at this human. Or sometimes, because of this face tracking algorithm, it was seeing a face in the environment, on the ceiling or wherever, and was starting to stare at it for a long time, exactly like somebody was living in its own world. So it became very fascinating to just look at the behavior of this robot. So these are the prototypes that I had at the beginning. And that's the recent project I worked on with Louis-Philippe that sort of we started touring in 2015, but in fact we started to work on it a few years before, called Inferno. And Inferno is a piece, a performance piece, where we invite the viewers to wear the robot on themselves. So we developed sort of a not too complicated exoskeleton machine in which the viewers are strapped. So our performers are, you know, just ordinary people from the street, people who are not aware of what will happen. And you see this on this image, the participants being briefed at the beginning of the show. And then they become part of the show as they wear the robots and they're being controlled by the whole system. So in this spectacle, the infernal piece, the infernal sort of aspect of the piece is not something that is really expressed so much, because the paradox that we discovered with this is that by being controlled, the viewers seem to enjoy it more than what we thought. So in all the documentation we have from the project, especially the video documentation, you always see people, you know, smiling and having fun and enjoying being totally helpless in this robotic suit. Here you have another moment, interesting moment in the piece where we also invite another person that we pick in the crowd, and this person wears, in this case, a controller. So this viewer simply controls the other viewers wearing the robots. This happens for maybe 5 minutes in the show. And that may be to a sort of start creating the transition to Louis-Philippe's talk. We see Louis-Philippe in the studio when we were working on replicating the exoskeletons for about 25 times. And maybe just a little peek to finish on my latest project called Copacabana Machine Sex, which is a burlesque robotic cabaret show, a bit like a little carnival of robots. That is simply also a way to attempt making something really kitsch, as well as, you know, still having some kind of reminiscence from the industrial look of the robots that we've been making for years. But this one is going to incorporate all the techy, disco, cabaret type of things. And what you don't see in those images is the robots wearing feathers and bling bling type of decorations. And yeah, so this ideally would be finished next winter. And the other project that I'm working on is a clinic of robots called Intensive Care Unit, based on some personal experiences that I have with the healthcare system, but that I will replicate with machines. So thank you very much for listening to this talk, and I will leave the microphone to Louis-Philippe for the presentation.
Alright, so first of all, thanks to come here again on Saturday morning, and mostly thanks to Massimo to give us me and Bill, Elizabeth, to give us a chance to talk about robotic art and what happens. And since, as you've probably seen, I work quite a long time with Bill. And not to repeat too much about the same, I just wanted more to focus, let's say, go through chronological order first and then to a recent project, but just to go through different steps to probably explain, for instance, why we're interested in doing Inferno at this stage and not maybe 15 years ago or something. So it came to happen in terms of development in different contexts we've been playing with. And what happens is I'm interested with the robots. I'm interested in an encounter with the machine, and to make it, I use the word radical, but something that is, let's say, in an ideal way would be almost life-changing, or at least something that you've never encountered before. So this is why I call it radical. So there's something different about being touched by a robot, being confronted by a robot, which is a new experience. So I'm more into really giving a context where people have experiences with the machine, which are more sensual than intellectual. This is not something that is based, let's say, heavily on conceptual art. You don't have to read the signs on the wall. You don't have to read the catalog. This is something that you experience with your senses, and then you can intellectualize afterward. I'm more into works of art that I can describe in one line. Somebody asked me about, let's say, the robot here in the middle, which is the blind robot. He asked me what it is as well. It's a robot that touches you. Inferno is a performance where you wear the robot, and so forth. So things that have only one line, a bit like when you see an image, you start filling in the gaps in your own mind, in your own experience about something. So a lot of time, like, we don't rely heavily on the narrative structure. It's always something that really challenges you as a body. And of course, if you start thinking about bodies, this is especially phenomenology and things that are happening recently about embodied cognition and new ways of looking at AI, everything pretty much is, you know, the root of our, let's say, intellectual comprehension of the world is always based on our bodily sensation. So, going through the body as a robotic encounter, then after we go a bit further. So, I'm gonna go and show you a few little situations of the past and past projects to show about, like, what it came into having robots attached to bodies, robot that touches you, and so forth. To go back to the early works in the, let's say, the 90s era and so forth, like, really interested in artificial life, recreating a spark of life into the machine, but it's somehow it chimes with what Jessica Riskin, when she described machinery as, there's something about machine that we don't want to make them lifelike, but at the same time we don't want to make them lifelike because life is something that belongs to us, or we have a soul and so forth. So there is no possibility of mechanical reproduction. And at the same time, when you look at performances, and early example of performances by Vaucan Snow with very odd object, which is a duck that could eat food and after a while generates excrement. So it's quite intriguing that this was the situation of a performance back in the 18th century and generated a big discussion about the bodily function of the duck and saying if it's there or not. So all these illusions of life, because actually this is all totally fake, it's a very odd context. Why is it so interesting to have a duck which is part of a music performance that actually has a dump in the middle of a performance? It's a very, very odd context to just rethink about this object as an object of a performance value, but at the same time it generated a lot of discussion and it really reflects what people are doing these days, you know. Think about the defecating duck as like a representative of a deep AI learning of the time. So a lot of these machines are about recreating life, so you've seen a lot of those in Bill's discussion, so presentation. So they were all about trying to insufflate a sense of living, a sense of, let's say, maybe agency, a self sense of intention. And we're playing from very abstract shape to more zoomorphic shape. And we're playing around with colonies, replicating the same object, and then at the same time having individual characters. So you start mixing all this together and you create ecosystems or groups of interaction. And it was all about creating a sense as well, not only of life from the machine, but of a fiction or an environment, a fictitious environment of themselves being machines, where we are sometimes part of it, but sometimes not part of it. So try to get to break away of the anthropocentric nature of the machine, because every robot that you see described most of the time, especially when it comes to a lot of robotic art, is very, very anthropocentric. But maybe you should think about freeing the machine first to really understand it. So it's all about these things that we're going to be talking about. So earlier in the presentation, there was discussion about the presentation that they were bringing the topic of behavior as something that was important in the development of, like, those cybernetic arts and contemporary art and so forth. So what happens is when you look at objects, when they behave in the front of you, let's say this little object goes and jumps above an obstacle. So if you remove the obstacle, you don't understand the intention of the object. So a lot of time we play on this, very simple, low level, and this is where we start building La Cour des Miracles, like the misery of the machine. The machines, they don't have pain. They are built with similar principle of bottom-up AI, not top-down AI. It's really natural computing, it's come from the structure, but the idea is like the small behavior that we try to decode and we interpret them, us as a perceiver of the situation as misery. That's very, very important. We set up the stage, you know, we just give a word and that's enough. And at the same time, we create structures that are sometimes misleading, sometimes very representative. So for instance, if I create this quickly, you recognize this? Now I can tell you this is a human body walking, that you will recognize it. So we play a lot with these two ingredients as fooling you with the perception with all kinds of tools. Tools from theater like strobe lights, smoke, structures that are behaving in a certain way that shouldn't behave this way. So if you make a robot with legs, but maybe you shouldn't make it walk, you should maybe do something different. So always confusing, disrupting the perception of the person. So these are little examples, like so. Up there, this is the arresting machine in action. And this one is the heretic machine. Just little, basically it was just a robot that just go and charge the cage and shakes it and tries to get out of it. What happened in there, like, well, Bill mentioned this, and it's the old environment which is important, which is a different action than a strictly sculptural action. A sculptural action, you put the object on a pedestal or an environment and you look at, you know, the sublime aspect of the object and you see it. In this case, we overload this space with different kind of moving object and they all become together the new object. So one object on its own is not so relevant, it's only part of a bigger ensemble. Another thing about robot is, of course, we believe there's something more to it than what they are. And as Lewis Mumford really cornered about technology in the early century essays, is like, when we look at the machine, we believe that this has a goal or some certain effects. So we totally believe into this. And below this is the example of the chess player, which is a good example of lures. People believe that there's actually a machine who could play chess, and of course it was a hoax, somebody was hidden in there and they could convince people that this machine was actually playing chess. And this is all reflection about, let's say, change this to the Deep Blue from IBM, change it to what people are telling you about what's happening with technology. It's always the same principle operating in terms of, like, we really want to believe. And same thing, Tesla did the same. Exactly the same stunts when he showed his wireless submarine. Tesla was a showman as well, so when he showed his first experiment, I think he did it in Washington, and he was just having these submarines going around and saying, like, look, these things are behaving, and he used a very beautiful word for them, they have borrowed minds. He didn't use teleoperation, he said they have borrowed minds. And people were mesmerized, of course, because they didn't understand, and they go, okay, it seems like it's behaving, and so forth. And then there's only a little step to all kinds of objects that are recreating something that are, we want to believe that they're behaving in a certain way, but are they? Big, big question mark. And it's the same thing, and even in art, this is actually, there's a lot of people who are replicating themselves with what they call American dolls. So people are doing the same scenarios you find in social robotics. They do it with their dolls. I mean, actually, fascination of dolls and robotics is tightly close together. If you go from Edison to Casanova, and all the, there's a lot of people that were like living with their dolls, and they were the Sandman and so forth. So there's always a replication of the human body that's interesting, that fascinates people. But we're more in the line of, let's say, Norman White's seminal work, which is called like, The Helpless Robot, which is a robot that cannot do anything. And the agency of the robot comes only because you manipulate the robot in the room. And this is much more effective piece than probably any of these ones, but this thing has only wheels and a box and a speaker. So it's something to question about what is happening. So when we start playing with lures and situation, like Bill mentioned Le Procès, which is Kafka work on the stage, the fascinating part of it is when we perform the piece, it's about like 15 minutes with robots above people and in the front. People come after and then they comment, say, okay, I saw Kafka work, and we just go, yeah, great. But has absolutely nothing to do, it was just a title. We didn't use Kafka work at all. The only thing that was interested in this is that you see this stage is open on both sides, and that was the starting point to say, okay, who's the jury, who's the condemned person, so who's who in there. So that was the linking point. And in terms of things that are behaving as well, looking more at correspondence, which is an AI problem. We look at AI like a view of, let's say, behaving. So now there are different objects that could behave somehow like in a similar way, like helicopters and drones and birds, they can hover. So there's all kinds of function. And I can walk, like a robot might walk, there's all kinds of animals walk in a certain way. So there's a lot of things that we share together without maybe having the same anatomy or the same essence or the same like intention. So a lot of time when we, if you look at the misery of the robot before, like it's because we share something somewhere that we can somehow link to the object, but we can be as well far away from it. This is a character made for a performance, 2001. It's a walking table. More skating than walking. But the main idea about the gait of the robot is to make it very laborious and very difficult. Because this is the opening of the show and the machine actually crosses the stage over half an hour. And when it reaches the corner, then another section of the show starts. So. But people can relate, you can relate to the object walking in a certain way because you can walk as well. So they were like roots of things that I'm more interested these days, as it will be more clear a bit later. And to go back to abstract and let's say situation about behavior, like this is actually an arena made of 48 robots, so a reverse the theater situation where you have all these robots kind of like being in a, let's say, more totalitarian kind of moment, and they just cheer for the people who are underneath them. So just a reversal of theater. And as well, I'm always interested in AI, and I'm very interested in confronting, of course, the what they call the good old-fashioned artificial intelligence, like top-down, Cartesian, like everything is in the brain. Into like something more bottom-up. Things are more simple, more like Rodney Brooks, with robots from his company today. More into looking at the way that we perceive intelligence is not a sacrosanct thing, but we still stuck with the Cartesian model of being like the brain is there. So the intelligence of an object is much more than the object itself. It's actually its context. We only intelligent here. A fish is intelligent in water, but not outside of water, and we vice versa for us. And the context, and depending where you put the object, it changes behavior, its nature, and so forth. And this there is, I don't know if you're familiar with this, but this is the write-up of artificial intelligence by Minsky and McCarty back then.
And it was a summer workshop, and they quite pompous description of what they can achieve with modeling. So you can probably model everything. And what is quite interesting is like most of the problem could be solved with a group of scientists over like a summer period. So it's kind of quite hilarious that you just go like, I'm going to throw a few PhD students at this, and the problem is going to be solved. But the main point here is when you think about that approach of AI is to accept that everything can be modeled. And I think one point of coming from the art side, a lot of time, because you know we come from more an intuitive aspect of it, we don't model things, we just build them. The models always come after, or the discussion come after. So it's a bit of a different level, or I won't say not a clash, but it's very different alleys we take in terms of modeling. And when you start playing with robots and making things, you really see that actually models do fail, and it's we have better luck with emergence. So that's one piece that I did about pastiche of AI. These are two versions. This is 60 skulls that are staring at you when you go around the space. This is the recent version. So basically, it's all about mimicking gaze, which has been really, let's say, put forward by, let's say, people at MIT about the role of gaze in social discussion and so forth. So it's all playing on these things. And try to create the strange kinds of uncanny somehow. And as many things that we discover through time, people are more, they just want to play with these things. They're not afraid of anything anymore. When they look at this skull rack, because this is based on a Mexican construction, they have skull racks in the front of the city to scare people to come in their neighborhood. There's all these same ingredients, but nobody looks at this, and they just play with these things, and of course they take selfies and so forth. So that's people totally reappropriated these objects that, let's say 20 years ago, people would say, like, I don't know, this is a bit too gore, or a bit discomforting. So the uncanny is a big question as well. Body shapes. I think when we look at robotics, to open up the anatomy of the humanoid, I think we really should think about robots as something that we build anatomies and then we see how it behaves. To build a robot that is similar to a human, yeah, sure, I can understand the built environment of the humans makes sense, but I think if we really try to understand what happened in a true genesis of, let's say, intelligence and behavior, anatomies should be of any kind. So I've been playing a lot on stage and trying to change the anatomy of dancers and disrupt their function, very similar to when modern dance or contemporary dance started breaking the vertical line of ballet. So you start to disrupt their movement. So attaching machines on their back and so forth. So I can just play a little bit of this one. Give you a little feeling about. And when these objects are built, actually the old structures is something I borrowed from engineering. This is a variable geometry truss that I put on the people and so forth. So I use those as construction blocks. And this is a bit more recent, following like research done at many places about exponyms for, let's say, MIT research, like to have workers to be able to have many hands to construct airplanes and stuff. So like this is done in Korea where people in the front, they all have like at least six extra limbs on their body when doing a performance. So to come closer to all these different constructions, so of course these days about the body, a lot of people from AI, like Wolf Pfeiffer and many other people as well, have been looking at the body involvement in AI, but as well in philosophy, in the flesh, and you know, a lot of titles like Metaphors We Live By and so forth. So a lot of elements are that very, very high level concept always based on your body and your body in the space. simple example, when you talk about the future, it's always pointing forward, never backward. Backward is the past because we walk forward. So all these elements are deeply rooted. And what happened is a lot of these bodily senses. And this is what I'm looking at these days. I just go back to, let's say, almost the early thing about the misery of machine, and I'm looking more at animals. So if I start reading about animals, it's very, very similar. In this text here, you can just substitute the word animal to robot, and this works as well. So the thing is, like, when we look at animals, we can identify to them. At the same time, we just distance ourselves from them. That enables us to use them in all kinds of ways. This is what we've been doing with animals, especially animals on the stage, animals in movies, and so forth. So, Radical Encounter and AI, I just want to show you little objects that are about AI. Here it's a robot made by the AI Lab Zurich. It's called Stumpy, very, very cute. If you want to relate a bit to this object, you try to imagine walking without bending your knees. Okay? So that's the way this object walks. And now if I play it again, then you establish a different relation. Oops, sorry. Now you understand more the way the object walks. So actually, I did a piece with 32 of these cute little robots. It's called the Telegrams. And the title will be self-explanatory very soon. It's a mixture of being like very abstract, but at the same time slightly visceral, and in a total chaotic environment. As you've seen, I did a lot of stage work before, like dancer. So this was my getting back at modern dance. There's a lot of pastiche of modern dance movement, and just deconstructing the whole aspect of it into some kind of very abstract construction. And just as I told you before, I did perception of these little robots, so I actually could measure slight difference if I tell the focus a group to say, okay, if you identify to this robot, people will relate to the object in a different way. And just for instance, if I play this tape, this video, I don't know if I have, maybe the. If I have two robots together and one robot by itself, it's always showing all kinds of behaviors, and people, I was asking them to describe the behavior. So a robot by itself, never the word dance appears, but as soon as I put two together, the word dance appears systematically. So it was an intriguing notion. So going back to the lures, because I'm really interested into this, I just did a very complicated AI robot using borrowed intelligence. So it's a robot that touches you, and I will play like a documentation made by a group in Russia. So it shows more interaction with people. The other one is more experimental. So I just give you a bit of the feeling for it. Thank you.
вступаючи в вербальний контакт з роботом. Он деликатно исследует ваше лицо прикосновениями, подобно тому, как это делают слепые. Сможете ли вы довериться машине?
Just that, as explained, like I did as well, like perceptual studies of the machine, and the only thing I've done with this was to look at the influence of the title of a piece or the context, or where I could situate the intelligent or the intention. The people were touched by two scenarios. One was this is the blind robot, and he wants to touch you to recognize you and so forth, little context. And the other group was this is a device made for doctors, it's to check if you're in good health whatsoever. Of course, people prefer to be touched by the blind robot as opposed to the instrument, which is a reverse result that appears in clinical study. In this case, people, because they understand the intention of the object, instead of just charging you, they say, okay, he wants to touch me. And people trust this because it's blind, so it's afflicted, and so forth. In the other sense, like if it's just a cold machine, you will refuse it. Yeah, so that's the blind robot. And then to go to Inferno, so like, and then I can play a video, so that's a little dessert for it. It also said a little bit more background on Inferno, and as well is. I couldn't resist to quote George Orwell and Eric Blair, if you want, because that's what's happening in Inferno. People get freedom from the slavery of the machine. Inferno is, of course, since we're in Italy, like of course Dante comes to mind, of course. But when we started looking at different ways, like Bill mentioned. When we're thinking about having an exoskeleton being controlled, we're just going like, well, this would be unbearable for people to make them do a performance of an hour, so it's going to be a bit like hell. So this is where we started going towards that alley. And at the same time, this is in Singapore. This is called Our Part Villa. This is, as Dante, is our circle of hells, things from the Buddhist side. So it's all like a system of sins and punishments and so forth. So we were kind of intrigued by the kind of sense of infinite punishment of what's happening in the post-life. And a machine is supposedly to be infinitely doing something, but at the same time, a machine is so mundane, it's so boring that, you know, it's, imagine if you do the same movement for the rest of your existence. There's something terrible about this. And at the same time, in the middle here, this is Joey, the mechanical boy. He was believing that he was being controlled by some external forces and so forth. So there are all these ingredients that we look into when we start manipulating people, literally. Going back, of course, to Tesla. Teleoperation, if you go here, like Da Vinci surgical instruments, like of course made for something purposeful and useful, but we pastiche this in the other direction of looking like what can we do with exoskeleton? It's actually not an exoskeleton that helps you doing something. It's an exoskeleton that forces you to move. That's very different. And then we just dance. We do a modern ritual of useless, let's say, production. Good old Walt Disney. And here, like this is in, I think, Philips Pavilion. Or General Electric, I'm not sure, full World Expo, like people could come and see people manipulating like radioactive material as a performance. So somehow now what we're doing, Bill and I, we're some moments like manipulating people, and people are just coming to see a bunch of other people being manipulated and going into a ritual, and just later to conclude the talk.
Thank you.
while this is playing, a very important notion of the piece, the people you see there, they untrain. We just tell them stay away from neighbors so we don't hit each other, and that's about it. So they are doing whatever you want, and so some start dancing, some are just more rigid. I think it's very important that for us, when we did this, we have no clue what it would give. Even the first show, we never tried it before the premiere with 24 people. We tried it with 4 people a year before in a small studio, so it was kind of a leap of faith that we did this action. But at the same time, this piece would not work at all if it was done with 24 professional dancers. This will totally defeat the purpose. This becomes much more interesting in terms of a ritual or a happening that is, it's the people, it's their own experience, the people, they dance for their friends, they do their own thing, and at the end, this is probably why one of the many reasons they start having like pleasure with the piece, which is kind of a huge paradox. Thank you.
Do you know if in the audience is there any question, especially to Bill and Luis Felipe? They have presented very interesting work, state of the art in terms of kind of technologies and art. I don't know. But I have a question, which is essentially theoretically, you know, if
our studies, you know.
We try to find a kind of description in terms of to be able to describe
how
this kind of robotic art topic is evolving, you know. Which kind of basic classifications of systems or of installations do you think it is the best one? Because as we have seen today, applications of robots are very various, you know,
spanning from different functionalities.
One, for example, is that of being able to replicate the way in which the behavior in which an artist is performing a picture. The other is to use this as a media for art. What is your, I prefer clearly this second approach. However, it is present also the other. Do you think that these things will go on, or, for example, artificial intelligence, deep learning, and so on, there will be that the first, that we, it will be the case that the first phase of being able to replicate the behavior of the artist will be really autonomous one day? I don't. There are two questions here. The first is taxonomy or...
Two questions, but so many answers. But, well, in terms of categories, like when we started doing that, there were no categories at all.
Yeah.
We didn't have any model, and it's... And of course, we're always sort of tempted to categorize things and say, well... But maybe that's something that we shouldn't... And you can still like look at it from, let's say, a very theatrical approach, or you can look at it from a more visual art, or from an engineering point of view, and just look at it as some kind of hybrid thing. Like it's a mix of different things that belong to different domains of research.
Mm-hmm. So, I understand, for example, if you see the categorization of new media art, is there. There are, for example, classifications of different streams of activities or play of installations that goes, for example, inside body, another, it is related, for example, to landscape or other things. This is one way, I understand. But it is still free. There is not already a canonical taxonomy.
There's no accepted one or accepted one. I mean, but some people are having little incursions in there. Like, for instance, artificial light was one. Real artificial light was one of the early ones. Or even before this, like cybernetics. Like if you think about the sensor, you know, the machine similar. So there was that model, a behavioral model about the object. And I think, I mean, there's the object itself, but sometimes you can look at it from the context it's used, because there's things that are called contestational robotics, so made for activism. There's different, you can look at it not even without thinking about the robot, but what you're doing with this. So they, I think a model exists from the slant you want to analyze it. So, and from my side, since I don't really like models, so I just go like, I'm more into natural computing or like morphological computing. Things that, you know, like I constantly repeat this, the world is its best model. So, and that's a beauty, I mean, for me as an artist, the beauty of a robot that is, exists in the world and it does things on its own just because of being
in action. So
that could be maybe one of another branch. But I think even the categorization of robots, I mean, there's been a few that happened, let's say, about 10 years ago.
A recent one, maybe I think Simon
Penny came back with more behavioral cybernetics, but they to have like similar, let's say, taxonomy, you would have to painting. It's good that we're not there yet.
Okay, and
but don't forget this phenomenon of knowledge that we want to believe what we want, what we have in front of us. So when you're talking about artificial intelligence and deep learning,
yeah.
Even from a scientist point of view, there's a creation of the make-believe. You know, they're producing something that they want people to project things over. So that's the way we work when we make those machines. So for us, it wouldn't be very difficult to make it with this idea.
Thank you. Other questions? Okay. So I think. Okay. So thank you very much, Bill and Louis-Philippe. Thank you very much also to Elizabeth, to Lorenzo, for their presence here today, and thank you to all of you for being for. Staying here with us today. Thank you very much. Bye bye. Here, as you have seen, and also downstairs, there is a room where the videos that by Bill Born and Griffith Demer are projected. Thank you.